stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us rejoice and give thanks to God for the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ that he won by his death and resurrection. It is for us that he has triumphed. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil that I have done and the good I have failed to do. You should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In his great mercy, God made us alive in Christ Jesus, even when we were dead in our sins. So, hear the word of Christ through his called servant. I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty God, by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you conquered death and opened the gate to eternal life. Grant that we who have been raised with him through baptism may walk in newness of life and ever rejoice in the hope of sharing his glory through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be dominion and praise now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord our God speaks to our hearts now through his word. This first reading from the Old Testament book of Exodus in chapter 15. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. The horse and its rider he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior, the Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has hurled into the sea. The best of Pharaoh's officers are drowned in the Red Sea. The deep waters have covered them. they sank to the depths like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, was majestic in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shattered the enemy. In the greatness of your majesty, you threw down those who opposed you. You unleashed your burning anger. It consumed them like stubble. By the blast of your nostrils, the waters piled up. The surging waters stood firm like a wall. The deep waters congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy boasted, I will pursue. I will overtake them. I will divide the spoils. I will gorge myself on them. I will draw my sword and my hand will destroy them. But you blew with your breath, and the sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Who among the gods is like you, O Lord? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders? The word of the Lord. Alleluia. The second reading written for us by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15. We will give our attention to this for the sermon. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it was I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believe. The word of the Lord. Alleluia. Please stand. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. The Gospel of the Lord.
Alleluia.
Seated, please. The hymn of the day is printed in the service folder, number 720, Christ Jesus Lay in Death's Strong Bands. Please follow the instructions as to who's singing what stanza as it is printed in the actual verses. So the men of the congregation will sing stanza 3, the choir will sing stanza 4, the women of the congregation will sing stanza 5.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. I will not die but live. And will proclaim what the Lord has. Hallelujah. I find a tremendous amount of irony. That while they were trying to find a reason to crucify Jesus, the Jews exchanged the truth for lies. And in the attempt to cover up Jesus' resurrection, they did the same. And they were quite unsuccessful. But it is quite unbelievable, isn't it? But it doesn't surprise us. Because all that we need to know about God and our salvation is quite unbelievable. That God be three persons, yet one God. That He created all things in 6 days with His almighty power. That the Virgin conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. That Jesus is fully God and fully man. And now today, that the dead are alive. All unbelievable. But as the Apostle Paul makes clear, all of our salvation from sin, all of our hope for this life and for the next life rests upon these truths. There is no doubt. Jesus lives. Now for a moment, please, listen to those who testify to this truth and be filled with the power of Jesus' resurrection. Of course, as the Apostle Paul relates this to us, he makes it clear that really to prove Jesus' resurrection is not necessary whatsoever. And why is that? Well, let's get to the witnesses in just a second, but you heard him say twice that all of this happened. Why? According to the Scriptures. According to the Scriptures. It happened this way because God said it's going to happen this way. And so there is no doubt. This is true. Jesus said. He made testimony of this as the angels reminded those that came to his tomb. Remember how he told you? It wasn't just once either. And even the Jews tried to twist the truth into a lie because they accused Jesus of saying, I'm going to rebuild this temple, or I'm going to destroy this temple, and it's going to be rebuilt in 3 days. But then, of course, Jesus was also fulfilling what was said by David. Holy One will not see decay. God has told us. This is true. Jesus lives. And this would be enough for us, wouldn't it? That God simply tells us. But yet human nature demands proof. It demands facts for truth. And it says, show me. Why? Because our human minds, our human hearts look at life and say it can't be true. If this is true and what God says is true, how can I be without job? If this is true and what God says is true, why am I all alone? Why do I not have love? If this is true and what God says is true, why do I not have health? Why is my heart not at peace? But we know what's at the heart of every doubt, that Jesus has lived and died and rose for our sin. It is sin itself that makes us want to believe the lie that none of it is true. And even then, sin piles itself on itself in guilt and shame, who bring us to despair and say none of it is true. So God has not only told us this. Listen to the witness. And there's even more than the list the Apostle Paul has. The women at the tomb. Yes, the apostles in the upper room. The Emmaus disciples. The apostles again and again in the next 40 days. 500 at one time. And finally, even years later, to the Apostle Paul. Now, what would happen if you went into a courtroom and you tried to say it's not true against the testimony of 500 who perfectly agree? Who would be the fool? Jesus lives. There is no doubt. God has told us this. And He has provided the blessing of many, many witnesses for our benefit. So that today we grasp with all our heart this divine truth. Because if Jesus is not risen, I am lost forever. If Jesus is not risen, I will die in hell forever. But there is no doubt. Jesus lives. So what does this mean for us today? In a way, it gets us back the basics. And you heard Paul say that. The heart of the gospel. Nothing more than what he has shared, than what Jesus has shared, and nothing more than what the church continues to preach and proclaim to all. Jesus has lived. Jesus has died. Jesus has risen. And why has Jesus died? Jesus has died because he lived a perfect life without sin. Today, when we stand at the empty tomb, it doesn't mean for us that Jesus didn't die. Because he had to die. He had to offer to God the perfect sacrifice. And Jesus' resurrection proves the truth of his death. That in fact, all of our sins have been paid for. The death of hell has been suffered in our place. There is no doubt, because Jesus lives. And this is so vital for us as well. Because along with our Savior, we'll follow the same path of life and death, will we not? Everyone will die. But united with him in his death, we are also united with him in his resurrection, so it's perfectly simple, isn't it? If Jesus rises from the dead, so do I. If he doesn't, I don't. There's no doubt. Jesus lives, and so do I. Now, for whatever reason in my life, if I ever do doubt, all I need to do is go back here. And God will tell me this. Jesus has lived and died and rose. And if you're ever in doubt, then listen to Peter. If you're ever in doubt, listen to James. Listen to the women. Listen to the 500. Listen to the Apostle Paul. There is no doubt. Jesus lives. All sin is paid for. Because he lives, we also will live. And now what does this divine truth do for us in our life? What practical use is there? Well, the Apostle Paul makes that clear too. And the message of the gospel, so simple, so sublime, comes. It absolutely changes us. And Paul, no greater example than the Apostle Paul. What was he? One of the Jews who believed the lie. And attempted to kill the Church of Christ after his resurrection. But the power of Jesus living changed him. And that's what the power of Jesus' resurrection does for each and every one of us, because there is no greater change than from death to life. And the power of Jesus' resurrection has a great amount of impact on us, doesn't it, friends? It emboldens us to live for God and to live in love for each other. It is what the church proclaims clearly. Just think about this day especially, that we celebrate the power of Jesus' resurrection. Isn't hearts filled with joy today? Don't the songs of praise seem a bit louder? What is this Sunday like? How is it different than any of the other Sundays of the year? This is the power of Jesus' resurrection. But please, don't ever think for a moment that this lasts only for one. We dare not celebrate this day and simply walk away and say, "Oh, that's nice. I'm glad he did that for me. Let's get going. I have a reservation for brunch." The power of Jesus' resurrection changes us. It forgives us our sins. It brings us new life. It makes us to live not for ourselves anymore. The power of Jesus' resurrection is for us the confidence in life's lowest moments. Because the devil cannot rob this power and this truth from us. The power of Jesus' resurrection gives us joy in every high moment of life, because we realize that every good thing has been given to us by God in His grace. The power of Jesus' resurrection relieves us when the burden of sin drags on us. The power of Jesus' resurrection will comfort us and satisfy our. The power of Jesus' resurrection is that which turns grief into joy and wipes away every tear from our eyes, because the power of Jesus' resurrection changes us and changes everything for us. So be filled with the power of Jesus' resurrection. And do not only live in it for this moment, but know that the power of Jesus' resurrection fills every space of your lives and every moment of your lives. It influences every word, every act, every thought, every place your feet will take. So let the Jews continue to lie, deny the truth. Let the people in the world around us call us foolish and say things like, "Well, the Christians just stole a pagan holiday that didn't exist for 200 years until after they called it Easter." Hold on to this. Let it be your power for your living before your God. Be filled with its power every moment. Because today, there is no doubt, Jesus lives. Amen. Please remain seated. This time we'll gather our offering. As the offering is gathered, please take the opportunity to find the friendship booklet in your pew, fill it out, pass it along to those who are worshiping the Lord with you today. Please stand. Let us pray for the whole Church of God and our Lord Jesus Christ and for all people according to their needs. All glory to you, dear Father in heaven, for you have kept your word and your promises to us, and you have brought your holy servant Jesus, our Lord, through death to new life and resurrection. Let this news of redemption through his blood spread throughout the whole world. By his death, he has trampled death. Hell is an uproar, and creation is renewed. Grant your Holy Spirit to us that this day you would become the foundation of our life and the strength in the hour of our death. Unite in joy your holy Christian church on earth to celebrate the resurrection of your Son. Put an end to all division and false teaching within the church. You brought Noah and his family through the great flood. You brought Israel through the sea on dry ground. You brought Jonah up from the belly of the sea. Finally, you raised your holy servant Jesus from the dead. Raise up those who proclaim the gospel in every city and land, to shout this good news, and to give voice to choirs to sing alleluias without end. Grant that the name of Jesus be heard in every corner of the earth this glad day. Now, by the power of your Son's resurrection, we implore you to visit the sick, the suffering, those at home, and those who grieve. When our last hour finally comes, bless our graves and remember us on the last day, that our lowly bodies be transformed by Christ's glorious body in the power that enables him to subdue all things to himself. Lord Jesus, you did not spurn the virgin's womb, neither did you hesitate to suffer all, even death for our sake. We praise and magnify your name now and forever. Be with us now each day as we follow you, and be our Redeemer, even from the grave. To you will we live, to you will we die, and yours we will be forever. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is good and right so to do. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose from the dead in glorious triumph, who bring forgiveness to the world, an everlasting life to all who believe. Therefore, with angels, with saints in heaven, and with the faithful living on earth, united in joy, we sing an endless praise. Blessed are you, O God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his victory over the grave, our Savior declared death's reign ended, the door to heaven open, and the payment for sin complete. We celebrate with joy the glorious resurrection of your Son. We marvel at the depth of your love. We stand in awe of your power. We are humbled by the compassion you have shown our fallen race. Lead us to rejoice in the pardon offered and sealed in this sacrament, and to live a life worthy of your name. The Lord Jesus lives. Alleluia. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Celebrate the Lord's Supper. It is not for everyone. And as we celebrate it, we express the relationship we have with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, but also we express the relationship that we have with each other, the oneness and unity we have as a family of Christ. If you are a visitor with us this morning and a member of another Wisconsin Synod Church, you may join the members of Grace to receive the Lord's Supper at this time. If you are from another church, another Christian denomination, and would like to learn more about becoming a member of our church, or learn what the Bible teaches regarding the expression of fellowship in the Lord's Supper, please speak with me after the service and we'll make arrangements to discuss it. As we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we sing hymn number 152, I Know That My Redeemer Lives.
have received the true body and the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. May it strengthen, may it keep you in Christian faith for life everlasting. Go in peace with joy in your hearts. Your sins are forgiven.
O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet that you have given us to eat and to drink in the sacrament. Through this gift, you have fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people, until that day when you will receive us as your guests forever at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. We sing the hymn "In Christ Alone" printed in the back page of the service book.